Hello, hello, hello. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome. Is the mic good? Does it sound all right? Not too loud? Good, good. Guys, welcome to our 2024 HR and hiring trends. So excited to have you guys here. We know that tomorrow is a holiday, so it's even more exciting that we get to spend the last day of the week with you guys. Today's going to be a spectacular night. We're going to be speaking about new tech, new talent, and new tactics in the HR and hiring space. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Francois, our CEO, and have a lovely evening, guys. Thank you.
There we go. Good evening, everybody. I asked Simba at the last minute to do the welcome, and he just told me he's very nervous, so he forgot three things. But Simba, that's perfectly fine. It's not a problem. I'm quickly going to fill in. So before we get into the evening, just some house rules. The bathrooms are on the right, if you haven't seen it yet. I did see the majority of you having drinks and food. The door is now closed, but don't worry. We're going to open it up again at the end of it. And so there'll be a lot of food and drinks still left for all of you. And then the last important thing, and it took us, because this is the fifth event, it took us a couple of events to notice this, but somewhere during the evening, this office park closes down the bottom gate. Okay, there's some, you've been stuck there. Regulars, my renter crowd. So please exit at the top, whether you're driving yourself or going with an Uber. A very, very warm welcome to our event, 2024 HR and Hiring Trends. It's phenomenal to have all of you here. Thank you. Thursday evening, just before Easter, I was worried that no one is going to come. We had 571 registrations for this evening, and I think somewhere it leaked that we send the recording. So people registered to get the recording, which is also perfectly fine. But I want to commend all of you for coming out. Can I start by asking, who is here for the fifth time? Woo! Wow! Thank you. Thank you. No, there's two, three, four. Thank you so much. Appreciate that so much. For those of you who don't know, my name is Francois de Wet. I'm the proud founder and the CEO of Wamly. I'm a registered industrial psychologist with more than 10 years of experience helping clients like yourself hire better people faster using tech. It's been a phenomenal journey. I'm quite gray for 37. But dealing with corporate South Africa and the world and bringing solutions to the table is my passion. I absolutely love systems. I love technology. I love making things easier. And what a better space to do that in the South African context with hiring and recruitment. And people often ask me, like, Fran, you guys are a tech company. Why do you do this? Like, why host a free event? And the answer is always the same. And that is, hello, guys, there's a lot of seats down here. Please feel super free and welcome. The answer is always the same. The answer is, I believe that the South African HR landscape needs more opportunity to connect. I think the one thing that COVID taught us, and thank goodness the majority of us have forgotten the C19 label, but the one thing it taught us is that we are built for connection. We crave connection. I often speak to people who are now fully remote, and they have this big smile on their faces, and then I dig a little deep and I go, but what do you miss? My people. And so an evening like this is one of three initiatives apart from our company that we do to bring people together. And so I want to encourage you tonight to, we're a small enough group, to ask questions, to engage, to challenge, to facilitate, to meet new people. I heard two phenomenal stories before this evening started where someone found a successor for their role from this community, and then someone meeting for the very, reconnecting for the first time since 2012. And yes, it's an ah moment, right? Ah. But that's exactly the point, is we want to create spaces where you're able to connect, hopefully learn, and I'm super excited about this evening. So from an agenda perspective, this is what we're going to do. I'm briefly going to share more about who we are and what we do, and then I'm going to talk about the 2024 trends. My word, I've been reading and listening and reading some more and listening, and it's fascinating out there. So I can't wait to share my perspective and thoughts on this. And then we are so privileged to have Devandré here in the audience tonight. He's going to be delivering our keynote. I'll properly introduce. Where is Devandré? Oh, here you are. Hello. Properly introduce Devandré after the trends. And then we're going to have a Q&A, which we always do. The Q&A often is longer than the keynotes. So, and again, it's because people have this need to talk and ask questions and challenge and be heard. I think that's one of the, without letting the cat out of the bag, one of the golden threads in the trends that you'll see tonight is this huge emphasis on the human. And then, like we always do, prizes. So let me show you, because people often say there's prizes, and it's like, who won it? No, it's Johnny. Okay, we have prizes, and we'll be handing out three prizes during the evening. So bear with me. Prize number one, and team, if I get this wrong, just tell me. Yes, Gideon, thank you. The first prize is chocolates. Okay, it is Easter. Okay, Bothlali is very excited. So the first prize is chocolates, and to get, I think I put this off. It's AI, ChatGPT. Thanks, team. So to win this prize, you need to take a photo, distribute it on social media, any platform of your choice, and tag us. But share a golden nugget or an aha moment that landed with you tonight. Is that clear? Okay, and the team will be looking at all the social media platforms, and we'll pick someone to win the chocolates. Second up, we've got a bottle of red wine. Beiersdorf Pinotage, proudly South African, absolutely love this wine. I don't think there's a way for me to win it, but anyway, this bottle of wine will be at the back end of Devandre's keynotes. I will be listening carefully, as will all of you, and then when we do the Q&A, I'll ask a question at the back end of his talk. And the person who answers it correctly will win the bottle of wine. Okay. And then the last prize looks beautiful, Prosecco. Okay. I only recently found out what Prosecco is. This is for a QR code that we've got at the back end of the evening. Okay. So I'm not going to share more about it now, but there'll be a QR code at the back end of the evening. It will take you about 15 seconds to complete it. And this will be randomized. Okay. Right. So let's get going. We spoke about the agenda. Let's start. Okay. Very quickly, the rise of Wamly. So in 2018, I started my career at a consulting firm specializing in psychometric assessments. Absolutely loved that season. Worked for a very nice firm. Some of you might use them at the moment for your assessments. But I had an itch. Some people call it a fire, itch, whatever you want to call it. And I wanted to break away and do my own thing. And at the time I was consulting, I spent about 18 months just consulting, carefully considering the landscape, looking at what organizations are doing, and something caught my attention. Like I became super curious, and that was something very boring, which is interviews, right? We all have them. We all love them. But I became curious around how do organizations do interviews. Started doing a lot of research, and at the time there wasn't a provider of one-way video interview software from a local perspective in South Africa. And so Wamly was founded in 2018, really as a side hustle. I was playing around, I was curious, I was trying to understand how to build tech. Industrial psychologist, can't code, how does this world work? But fast forward 2021, added 20 clients. I recently told someone that one of our very first clients, Annette, is sitting in the audience 4.5 years later. Thank you, Annette. Momentum, phenomenal to have you here. 2022, 200 clients, 20 staff members, 23 countries. 2023, we won Tech Startup of the Year in South Africa. Introduced more features, and to date, we've helped over 500 companies interview more, almost 500,000 candidates across 34,000 vacancies in 121 countries. And thank you. It's just been a phenomenal journey, building tech in South Africa, working with HR, and trying to solve a problem. And what is that problem? It is, we have thousands of people looking for jobs. We have thousands of companies looking for people. And there's this disconnect. And tonight, both Devandré and I will be touching on some of the reasons for that. But our mission remains, if we can just play a small part in that, where at least people have an opportunity to do an interview. And they're not sending their CV into the abyss and never hearing back, which we all know happens. An incredible journey. But tonight it's not about our stats and our accolades. Five easy steps to hire. I'm quickly going to show this to you. If you want to know more, come and speak to any of us. So basically, our clients have a platform. They set up their vacancies. This goes out and they attract in any way that you attract currently, job boards, agencies, recruitment agencies, your ATS. The candidates come in, and here are some screenshots. You review the video interview, you review the skills test, you look at the candidate's profile, and from Wamly, you decide and give scores and comments, and the panel collaborates all together. And really, from there, you decide who you want to progress to the next step in your process or reject. And so the sole purpose of the platform is not to do everything in the hiring space, but rather to save that time that you spend, your valuable time in interviews. Because let's be honest, people don't look like their CV. And within the first 5 minutes of sitting in that interview, you're like, is this going to be 45 minutes? And so that's what we're all about. And thank you to some of our incredible clients. I always say this, but Wamly would be absolutely nowhere without our clients, as all service providers. And some of you are sitting here in the audience, and I want to take this opportunity to just again thank you. Thank you so much for our support and for going on this journey with us. All right. Hiring and HR trends. Before I jump into it, reading and reading and rereading, and we compiled about 34 trends looking at various literature. And obviously, we don't have enough time this evening to share all 34 with you. Okay, so we will distribute to everybody who registered a beautiful report on these trends. Okay, so if you want to take photos, that's cool. You also want to win chocolate, so I understand. But we will distribute this. But I decided to pick 10 that interested me, that I thought was quirky or new. One has got a swear word in it. I'm not joking. And share that with you, because let's be honest, we've all heard that there's a conversation around mental health at the moment. It wouldn't add too much value for me to bring it up again tonight and say, and mental health, okay? So I'm not disregarding any other trends, and I'm not saying that these 10 are the only. These 10 just stood out for me. I thought they're fun to talk about. Second comment around the trends is that, and Devandré is definitely going to touch on this, we all have our own perspective and perception. And so we can read a trend report from Deloitte or Burson or Dieter Veltzmann, but how you contextualize it and your perspective and your context on it, that's what matters. And so tonight I'll be sharing the trend with you, but then I'll also be sharing my understanding, interpretation, and potential strategies around that trend. But it might be completely different for you, and that's okay. That's part of the evening. Is that good? Okay, we've got three mics roaming around, so if at any point you have this burning desire to ask a question, please do so, or contribute. Okay, we're good to go. Let's do it. Before I get into them, here's an overarching theme that I picked up, and that is, one, HR is definitely shifting. There is a shift in HR, and the shift is happening on three pillars, and When you see a better example of this in Devandre's slides, please note we didn't compare notes. That was just beautiful synergy. At least you know that we both prepared. Yes. But number one, HR is realigning its priorities. There's a definite conversation at the moment around what should we be doing, what gets measured, what is valuable, where do we have an impact? So there's a priority shift going on. Secondly, there is a consideration towards our current operating models. I just, in the loo, had a conversation with a friend who said, we're stuck. Let's just say it out loud. In most HR spaces and conversations, we are stuck. And the question now is the model that we are operating from still relevant? The SOP might say it. But this is how we do things here, Fran. Okay? But in 2024, in the literature, there's definitely a push towards reconsidering the operating models. And then lastly, there's this force behind HR, which is good. And the one particular trend, which is not part of the conversation tonight, that I thought quite interesting, and I wonder to what level it is relevant, or maybe has it made its way to South Africa, is HR is now, CPO is now adding to their title sustainability, right? Sustainability and the weather and floods. And do we have crisis plans? And what are we going to do when, hello, Stian. He sent me a photo 4 hours ago looking at Table Bay and now he's here. Stian, well done. Hello. There's this force behind, what are we doing to be good? How are we contributing and looking after sustainability? Another interesting trend, which is not in here, is around DEIB. Diversity, equity, inclusion, belonging. Did I get that right? Yes. And there's actually a collapse around it and a rethink. How relevant is that to the people in my organization? Okay, so the 10 trends I'm going to show you now all either belong to one of these three themes. So let's get cracking. Of course, a trends conversation would not be a trends conversation without us touching on and starting with artificial intelligence. So how do we embrace innovation in HR tech? I had the privilege last year to go to Paris. I have said this, but very few of you were at the previous event, so you will be hearing it for the first time, the majority of you. Massive tech conference. It was called Viva Tech. 170,000 people, 40,000 exhibitors from I don't know how many countries, tech everywhere, drones carrying humans, Audi car driving without steering wheels, medtech, fintech, edtech, it was insane. Guess what I didn't see? HR tech. And I was standing there going, this is impossible. Like, they're either not at the conference or there's something wrong here. And then I sat at a panel conversation where we asked the question, is Africa ready for AI? Guess what the answer was? An awkward giggle. And so there is no doubt that AI and generative AI, such as who's using ChatGPT? Who's got number 4? Huh? The premium. Have you found those apps that you can click on and now you've got yeah, super cool. So generative AI is helping us come up and generate pictures, video, text, content. But really the question becomes in the trends and the research and the literature is how do we really integrate it into our HR practices? So what do we mean? How we hire, how we onboard, the L&D, the performance management, the succession planning, the predictive analytics around it. And my personal, remember, perception and perspective and context, my personal opinion around this is I'm not sure if HR is clearly understanding how to engage with the AI. So we go to chat, which is easy-ish to do. Some of us still aren't there. You'll get there. But to really integrate it, that's, I think, where we need to go. And the caution around this is the ethics, the risks, the bias. Can we really trust the machine? Okay. People often ask me, so does Wamly have AI yet? And then I ask, okay, what do you mean? And then half of the conversation stops because they don't know what they're asking. The other half goes, well, surely with all the thousands of video interviews you're doing, the AI can score the candidates. And then I go, yes, that is a fantastic roadmap for us. Will your line manager take the recommendation from the machine on who to appoint without interviewing them? And so that's exactly the point, is can we trust it? What is the risks? Do we understand it? And is there an ethical framework around how to engage with it? The interesting part for me around this is, can you stop the revolution of AI? Probably not. There was this famous survey from the famous Elon Musk going, just hold on a bit, and it was completely ignored. So, fascinating. Don't look at me for the answers tonight. I'm sharing the information and my perspective, but a fascinating conversation nevertheless. Quick show of hand, who's using AI currently in their HR practices? Okay, some hands. The first one went up. Can I quickly ask you to share how? Yeah? Can we get a mic, please? Is it okay? How? Thank you. Thank you for clarification. Who's actually using it in HR? Yes. Okay. I'm not too sure if everybody heard that, but it's being used currently with the analysts, and it's challenging the analysts to think more. And so the comment is, it's raising the game. Now, from the research, two things I want to mention before I go on is, one, AI is closing the gap between the top performers and the average performers. So that's interesting. So it's playing that role where I'm going to help you. And often the conversation around, am I going to lose my job? Probably relevant. We'll do another keynote around that. If you don't upskill and reskill, which is your point, it's challenging you to be better and to upskill and work with it. The second stat is it's increasing productivity in the workplace with 42%. Now, if you think about it, it's replacing, it could, if you use it, it will replace the mundane, repetitive tasks. Okay, fascinating. Trend number two. Oh, you'll see I staggered the trends in terms of the employee life cycle. So we'll start with recruitment and then onboarding and then all the way. So the second one, I love this. This idea that recruitment marketing should be elevated. Who's passionate about marketing in the audience? A few, yes. The similarities between hiring and marketing are astonishing. Like, we're trying to convince someone to make a decision. This idea that your employees are now consumers with a choice and with preference, especially the younger generations. We have the actual very famous Mr. Gen Z Marco. Where are you? Did he exit? Okay, it'll be on the recording. I'm going to send this to Marco. I try to... Anyway, Marco was here. I hope he's still here. He's the Gen Z guy. And the Gen Zs, they're fascinating to get a hold of, to impress, to bring into your organization. And so how do we incorporate marketing strategies in the way that we attract and engage our talent? And you'll see there, I specifically inserted EVP because this is what it's about, your brand. Are you clear around your value proposition, the research is saying? Because it starts there. Do you know who you're looking for? Do you know where to find them? And then, very important, the marketing comes in. Do you know how to grab their attention? I quickly want to share a side story with you. So I said earlier we had over 550 registrations for the evening, 200 of those. So it was my birthday, the 15th of March. So my wife and I are sitting, enjoying my birthday, and I get a WhatsApp from the team saying, we just had in one morning 200 registrations for the evening. And I'm like, yo, I'm not sure that's possible. I mean, that's fantastic, but I'm not too sure that's possible. And so we backtracked it. And what happened was is someone made a TikTok video of tonight's event saying that if you are in the job market, come to the Wamly event because there will be HR professionals in the audience and 200 students registered for the event, okay? We then backtracked. We said, we're terribly sorry, the evening is not for you, but here's a link to a Wamly project. So they're all in, most of them, a lot of them are in Wamly now. And we are going to, because they're all IT students. So we got them into a Wamly pool, and we'll now make that pool available to our clients. But that's the power of a TikTok video that got 34,000 views in a morning on my birthday, and 200 students said, I need a job. So So, and this guy, Simba then got a hold of him. He's an influencer. And he's got a massive following. And with one viral video of 30 seconds, he was able to generate people that this venue could not accommodate. So what's the point here? The HR meets PR. And are you, the research is asking, considering the way you attract and engage your talent? Or is it the stock standard, my ATS shoots out to the job board, I wait, the candidates come in, there's 7 levels of approval, someone, poor HR, is sifting CVs, we're looking at knowledge, qualification, experience, skills, the shortlist goes to line manager doesn't look at it, you know the rest of the story. Average time to hire in South Africa, 52 days, average cost, 57,000 rand. That's the stat in South Africa at the moment, okay? And here is an awesome theme emerging in 2024 around leveraging the principles of marketing. One of our earlier events, we had someone on the stage talking about create an avatar. Okay? Do you understand this profile? I had a chat with Stian last week from Ocean Basket. Stian is looking for a very particular human to work for Ocean Basket. And so he's creating a model, an avatar around that human. And from there, creating a strategy to go and find these people. Next trend, there's a huge surge in skills-centric recruitment or hiring. What does that mean? Skills, since 2023, are starting to take the center stage in the job market. I remember I was at a conference last year. There was a gentleman from Deloitte, Sibusiso, and he stood up in his gray suit, and his entire talk was about this. And I sat there and I thought, what he basically said is, the Deloitte research is saying that we can actually chuck the job description and just look at skills. And I sat there and I thought, this is extremely interesting. Because we're stuck on knowledge, qualification, experience, and show me your degree, and you know all of these things that are conditioned into us around what to look for when we start hiring. And so this theme around, jobs are changing, organizations are changing, the landscape is changing. We aren't in the same environment than we used to be. And the biggest change is the competitiveness, especially with our scarce skills roles like the IT, the BAs, the world. COVID made, how many of your developers are now working in the Netherlands, but from their couch in South Africa? Yeah? So the research around this is saying, okay, how do you shift your perspective away from what you know and what you think you're looking for and what you think predicts job success and look at a skill-centric approach? For me, my perspective around this is it's very difficult to look for someone's displayed skills and competence in a CV and even an interview, right? You need in your hiring process, then if this resonates with you, to go and look at, okay, but how am I assessing for this skill, right? And there are various ways to do that, but that's something to definitely think about, because in the skills section in my CV, I can say Excel, okay, and VLOOKUP, okay, pivot table. But how are we actually ensuring that this is? And then once it's in, I think that's the next part of the research, is to say, okay, how are people then from a talent mobility perspective moving and shaping because they're chasing their skills? And one of the next themes we're going to talk about is the collapse of career path planning. And the reason around that is because of this conversation around skills. Does this make sense? Yeah? Who's doing this? Like, we've made a decision to adopt a skill-centric approach to the way we hire. Like, who can honestly, there we go, there's a hand. Fantastic. Can you share with the audience why? High level. We hired? Okay. Wow. Yes. Sure. Thank you for sharing. I think this will challenge us to let go of elements that we're stuck on, right? How often have you sat where the line manager goes against his own job analysis and his job profile? Yep. But you said 5 years. Yeah, but this is okay. Let's give him a chance. Okay, so there's some conditioning that needs to change here, but I agree, this is a cool theme. Next up, how do we align our work, our jobs, with meaning to increase talent engagement? Fascinating theme. Now, this theme is all around, is there alignment between what I'm doing and what the organization stands for? Or the other way around, what the organization stands for is not necessarily aligned with what I stand for and therefore what I'm doing on a daily basis. And some of the themes you'll see as we move through the themes start becoming deeply personal, of this one being one. So the research is emphasizing the need to start designing and aligning jobs with the individual's values and goals. Now, I looked at this as a business owner and someone who employs people, and I'm going, I hear you, research, but it's not that easy. Like, this is a bit, it could be a bit airy-fairy, right? Some organizations need a receptionist. And then I started reading deeper, and I realized it's not just in the job description, but also in the organization's environment, the interactions with the hiring manager or the peers, the opportunities that get given to individuals to voice their opinion around, well, I actually don't think we're living our values. We have this value called integrity on the wall, or we say we show up in this way, but I'm not seeing it. And is the leader open to that feedback? Are we encouraging that? The research clearly talks about jobs lacking social value. Sure, let that sit with you for a second. Jobs are lacking social value. Someone from the audience, try and explain what you think that means. I will not judge the answer. Yes, sir. Sure. How is a business analyst at a large bank understanding how his or her job is making the society in South Africa better? Did I say that correctly? Fantastic. This idea that the individuals understand how their jobs cascade back up to the purpose of the organization, but also the community at large. This is particularly profound in the research around the younger generations entering the workforce. What is your stance on green and that DEIB and social responsibility and DSG and all these abbreviations? But basically, like, what are you doing to make the society better, the environment better? And if we can find a way in your context to align and start at least creating conversations around alignment and shared understanding, this is what the research is emphasizing. Why? It's saying it will enhance the productivity, engagement, and job satisfaction of employees. And this is basically saying a sense of belonging. Like, I understand the why, I understand my part in the why, and therefore, I want to be here. Interesting theme. Makes you think a bit. Because this is counter to productivity, output, revenue, money. Right? And I mean, we're not NGOs. So how do you balance that? Which is my thinking as well. Oh, this was fun to read. Traditional stereotypes of career paths will collapse. So you know the career path conversation, right? This is A1 in the office. Francois, you are here. I am there. And this is your ladder. Right? And if you do X, Y, and Z, and we will remunerate and reward you on the way and provide training, and there's a job resource and job model conversation, and do they match job demand? Sorry. And the research is saying, this is falling apart. And here's why. Firstly, the ever-evolving nature of the world of work. Now, this is on a macro level, but this is also around something like company structures becoming flatter and flatter. It's like, I'll never forget, I was a student, and my mentor and good friend, you might know him, Fred Guest, was a speaker at our class. And we were super excited because TTS gave internships. So he's sitting there all smiling, and then Fred says, at the end of his presentation, he says, you're not really going to mean anything to me yet. When you come in, it's us that is going to give you the opportunity. And that was like a big eye-opener for me. And years later, I understand what he said. It wasn't a condescending statement. It was a statement around, you don't know anything yet, apart from your studies. And so come in and learn. But then the question becomes like, how can I get here? And how can I get here? And how can I get here? And I want this and I want that. And it was like, okay, just work a bit. And so the start of this research or this theme starts with, okay, firstly, that system is slowly collapsing. And it links back up to the skills-centric comment earlier that says, well, people aren't chasing necessarily a career path anymore, but they're chasing where they can apply their skills. And so we see interdepartmental moves and shifts between industries. My dad recently gave me a watch that he got from his father when Opa Gert made his 30th year at the cheese fabric in Koppies in the Vrystaat. 30 years employment. Okay, is there anybody in the audience who's doing 30 years at the same company? Okay, I won't judge. Okay, but we're seeing less and less of that. In fact, the research is saying people move every 18 months, right? 18 months. And so, okay, so what does that leave us with? The research is saying embrace talent mobility. Embrace the fact that this is a value transaction at a particular point in time where I'm bringing my skills to the table, you are asking me or instructing me or sharing an opportunity for me to show the skills. And we see this beautifully in the gig economy and freelancing and consulting. I can't wait for Devandré to talk a bit about unemployment and perception around that. He'll share something about that later on. But career path planning, it's just too quick, guys. The world is moving too quick. This idea that in 7 years I will be here in that department might not even exist in 7 months. Okay. The emphasis, the research is saying, is on the individual around how are you upskilling yourself? Because the longer you remain stagnant as an employee, right, you will become redundant and irrelevant. Thank you, Blockbuster, Kodak, and BlackBerry. Good examples. Who had a BlackBerry? 3310. Snake. Yeah? Sorry, millennials. That was an old phone back then whose battery lasted 5 days. Gen Z. Okay. Oh, here's my... Yes, comment. Yes. 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 Okay, so for those of you who didn't hear, the question was, how do I feel? I love the fact that you phrased it like that because now I can tell you how I feel and not what the research says. How do I feel about the fact that some organizations will instruct or advise employees to stay for 3 years because then you're not a flight risk? Here's my feeling around it. The conditioning from the hiring panel when they pick up a CV and see someone moved every 18 months is preset on Francois chasing money or Francois using us as a stepping stone to get to somewhere else. That's conditioning, in my opinion, from the hiring panel, missing out on the opportunity to see that what can I get from Francois in the 18 months? What can I learn from Francois? What can Francois learn from us? What can the peers learn from each other? And guess what? I spoke with someone the other day who's now been at a job for, I think, 7 or 8 years, and I asked why, and they said, because I never stopped learning. I've not been stopped challenging, being challenged. I still feel that I'm not sure what I'm doing. There's a penny drop. So that's my feeling. Okay. Here's our swear word. The end of bullshit jobs. It's a theme. We can clap hands if we want to. Let's clap hands. The end of bullshit jobs. So a gentleman by the name of David Graber coined the term bullshit jobs. And basically, they did a global survey. Almost 40% of British adults, 20% of US adults, 70% globally said they doubt if their job has got any value. Oh, that's harsh, eh? Like, imagine the scale of humans in the US alone, 20% going, my job doesn't have value. If you dig deeper in here, it's around, is there meaning and purpose behind what I'm doing? Okay, so now you start seeing a little bit of a golden thread around, this is deeply personal, the trends this year. And secondly, like, my job is the same every day. I'm maintaining processes. I'm maintaining a machine. I'm switching something on and off the whole time. I'm answering the phone with the same script the whole day. Like, there's no meaning. And 83 million jobs, according to the research, will be lost in 2024, and 69 million jobs created. So we can clearly see this massive shift. And can you guess what's the biggest contributor behind that? It's a word that starts with a T. Technology. We need to embrace and understand and accept the fact that technology is the answer to bullshit jobs. Okay. I don't really have much more to say around this trend, except that I loved it. Okay, here's a vulnerable question. Does anybody feel their job currently is bullshit? There's a vulnerable lady. Well done for being authentically vulnerable. My job is bullshit. Okay. There might be elements in all our jobs that we might deem to be bullshit, but at the end of the day, I think you need to go get mic'd up. Yeah. The end of bullshit jobs. Any comments on this?
So one of the latest developments that I saw was in robotics. They're starting to pair humanoid robots being powered with ChatGPT so that they're able to function in these so-called BS jobs. There's a company that just received seed funding to the tune of 100 million. Amazon, all these big tech names are pumping money into them. A lot of these mundane jobs that involve things like warehousing and stuff like that, they're gearing up to basically just build robots to fill those jobs.
I've never seen a cameraman participate. Yes. Okay. I couldn't help myself. Like, no matter how much I read, and I try and ignore this one because it's everywhere, it popped up over and over and over, and I thought, okay, let me just put it in. There's a theme once again and an emphasis on reskilling to retain people. Okay, so maybe this is a bit part your conversation earlier, is if we aren't emphasizing reskilling and uplifting and developing, we might struggle more with retention. And the research is asking employees to focus on equipment, but not equipment for anything, equipment for relevant skills. And then they go down into two rabbit holes. The research says, okay, equip Francois for the skills required in the current role, but then also in other areas in your organization. And I think that's probably, yes, you're shaking your head, what you guys are doing. So reskilling your employees to retain them. And then the research says, and there's this lovely quote, bumper sticker, CFO asks CEO, what if we train Francois and he leaves? And what's the second part? What if we don't and he stays? Yes. And so retention, we know. Attracting and retaining talent, massive conversation. All the themes from last year and the year before was the brain drain, the skills shortage, you know, COVID making the world really small, people working from anywhere and everywhere. But then the research becomes interesting because it stresses the fact that, okay, don't reskill Fran on what only you think, but also involve Francois in this conversation. Because remember some previous themes around meaning, purpose, passion, alignment for talent engagement is around, okay, but what is my plan for myself? We at Wamly, at the end of last year, we lost our office manager, Rosetta. She was with us for 3 years. I don't think Rosie would mind me sharing the story, but Rosie came in and she moved with Wamly in, I think, 3 or 4 different roles. And she was upskilling and reskilling herself the whole time. And then every time before she kind of got bored, she would come to us and say, Fran, I think I can go there. And then we would say, okay, that's cool, Rosie. What do you need? And then we have this conversation. And then at the end of last year, the next move for Rosie, we couldn't help her with. And we had this conversation where we said, Rosie, we can't reskill you further. And then Rosie went and now she works for one of our clients in the ideal jobs that you wanted next. But involving your employees in the process, aligning them with the jobs and what you have in your organization, and then also accepting if you're stuck. And then Fran then might go, and that's also okay. The research also says there's a focus on the environment. So the internal culture, the leadership structures, the opportunities for healthy, honest, open, transparent, radically honest conversations around, well, I'm not happy, I don't feel equipped enough to do my job. All right, cool, what can we do for you? Okay, is there a plan we can make? If not, why not? But at least having and fostering that environment where it's encouraged. But if done right, says the research, there's a hand. Career path ratio.
Yes. So we often try and get, because it is a course, we try and get our agents, or we rather call them consultants. They are call center consultants. We try and upskill them to perhaps a team leader role, and perhaps eventually a call center manager role. And hopefully it can go to an operations manager role, because our current operations manager started off as a call center consultant.
Yes.
But when do we know that we can't really do more, but we still need to? Do we give them more responsibility into their portfolio, or do we accept what we accept and say, we've done our best, it's up to you if you want to stay, but we can't upskill you anymore because this is what our capacity is?
Great question. Can I answer it from my perspective? Okay. Did everybody hear the question? Okay, I'm going to repeat it. What do I do as an organization when I provide opportunities and then at some point it's just not enough? Do I increase the portfolio and the responsibility, or I do just accept it? That was the, am I right? Was that the question? And it's in a call center environment. So my perspective is twofold. And I always say this when we have the conversation around PDPs, development plans, is it's not the organization's responsibility to develop. It's the responsibility of the organization to provide the resources and the platform and the opportunity. But it's the employee's responsibility to grab the opportunity and to run with it. Okay? And often you might find that what you have to offer is just not what they want anymore. People either move horizontally or vertically. So by increasing the portfolio, you're not really changing the job title. By increasing the responsibility, you're actually increasing the complexity in the same role, but that's not what they want. And I think we need to be able to have a mature conversation to accept that and then move on. Esli.
Yeah, thank you.
I want to end that off, this theme, with two comments on what both of you said and the question is, The first being that, remember, it's strategy, structure, people. It's very difficult to build a business around people and what people want and where people want to go, and they're changing their mind every second week, right? So how do you balance the business's strategy and why the business exists with what Francois now wants to do or doesn't want to do? And yes, there's the personal entity. I agree with you, Esli. That's why job crafting. But that transaction can end amicably. That word. It can end in a nice way, right? Stian, can I use your example around your... So Stian will always say that at Ocean Basket, they plan people's exit. Have you ever heard of that? Yeah. I like your face. You say, what? And quickly, Stian, like, why do you do that? Share with us.
I think I'm going to repeat what everybody's saying or what everybody is alluding to. So at the end of the day, it is about having a tough conversation. It's about having a human conversation. It's about having an adult conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the fact that you pointed out, like how do you approach that by having that conversation? If you lay the groundwork at the start and say, okay, cool, this is what we are in your life. This is what we can provide for you for 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, or 1 year. If you start off the conversation at this start off the conversation on that note, the productivity, the productiveness of that person, knowing what is expected, we find is higher.
Sure.
And at the end of the day, it is just about, you know what your worth is, you know what your value is. Mm. And at the end of the day, if you want to move there, you can move there. If you want to stay relevant, you stay relevant.
Yeah.
By saying more, I'm just going to repeat what everybody said.
Thanks, yeah. Tema.
I did worry around the new skills and including everybody with new skills, maybe a generational one, but the implications for deep skill and mastery is something that we have to watch out for.
Yes.
So we get, you introduce LinkedIn learning to organization or degree, and everybody goes and learns about everything.
Yes.
And as soon as something gets hard, they move from a secret private life.
Yeah.
But why, going back to your comment around the conflict, what we probably should be doing are deep skilled masters at their craft, because they beneficiate whole talents. And if we're so busy learning new skills all the time, you don't develop gurus that way. You develop masses of HD skill.
Mm.
And the HR professionals in this room are not looking to hire HD skill.
Sure.
I want an architect that just wants to be architect and they build everything from mud huts to skyscrapers.
Sure.
Because if I surround that person with a junior architect, they'll learn the same quicker. So how do you balance that? And for me, the retention here is not around retention of people, it's around the retention of skills in your organization that works.
Sure. Sure. That's power. That's power. I don't have an answer. I think one thing I would like to share is I recently had a conversation with an HRBP. HRBP's in the room? Who's been an HRBP? And the HRBP said to me that there's so much in my portfolio, I'm good at nothing. And can someone just please create a recruitment specialist team again, like it used to be? Like, take sourcing, like, there's too much systems, too much technology, too much processes, too much expected of me. I can't be good at anything anymore. So with just that one example, I think I agree with you. Retention of IP. I am cognizant of time, so there is a big Q&A at the end, so please just hold your hands. I just want to get and give Devandré his fair slot. We're almost there. This was good. Tackling e-presenteeism. Okay, so let's start off with what is presenteeism. People often think presenteeism is people are at the work, but they're not really there. I also, for a long time, thought that's a definition. Until I started reading deeper, it's that in a way, but what it is actually about is I'm not there, but you need to understand the why. And the why is that I am burned out, disconnected, because I'm overworked, overwhelmed, and I don't know how and when to switch off. I didn't actually know that second part of the definition. I just thought I'm showing my face, but I don't want to be there. Whereas presenteeism is, no, I don't have the emotional capacity to be there. And so in the research, 77% of HR experts have been witnessing this with fully remote work, hence the title e-presenteeism. And that this is a huge issue. And the long and the short around this theme is that the more we have these hybrid and fully remote working environments, the more we're really going to have to seriously look at this, because now I can't see Temba not being present while he's at home. Whereas at least at work, I can walk past my colleague and go, Fran, you don't look great, bud. Like, what's up? And then we can have that conversation. But now, who's doing that on Teams? We're not even putting our cameras on. Okay? I have a bad hair day. Didn't do my makeup. Like, we know the story. So this is a big theme for the year, is if you are in the hybrid / fully remote environment, understand that e-presenteeism is a thing. Why? Boundary management. That's the core of this theme, is organizations need to focus on how do they put in place structures, policies, procedures around when can you switch off, when can you switch on. I remember in COVID, thankfully Wamly is in the office, but I remember in COVID working at home going, one, where's my space? Is it my couch? Is it my desk? Is it the dining room table? Is it outside? And now when do I switch off? Like, when am I at home and when am I on? Whole separate conversation around the mental health implications for that, but definitely e-presenteeism being one of them. And now the research says an interesting thing, create a positive environment. And I'm reading that going, but they're at home. Like, what environment? So maybe someone in the audience can elaborate around, okay, but what are you doing with a fully remote workforce? Are you aware that there might be presenteeism, e-presenteeism problems? And how are you creating an environment to alleviate this? Super interesting. Okay, let me tell you what the research is saying. Clear priorities, clear structures, and then there's a big piece around, but lead by example. Don't email your subordinate at 2 o'clock in the morning, but then the next day say, I'm deeply worried about your mental health. Or remember to switch off, but then I'm always on and WhatsApping you at 10:30 at night. Tough conversation, boundary management, structure, policy, and then also living it, leading by example. The previous slide I actually didn't touch on had a cool word. I've never seen this. Work-life fitness balance. Have you read about that? Work-life fitness balance. There's a big trend this year or emphasis on physical wellness as well. Treadmills, let's go for a walking meeting. That's quite cool. We're going to walk. Okay, walking meeting. I know Devandré does walking meetings as well. So, emphasis on e-presenteeism. Two more to go. Empathy is making its way back in the C-suite. Can you believe it? There's some prayer. Are you praying? It's beautiful. The research is saying 32% of CEOs lack empathy. Okay? And now the shift is, but wait a minute. Empathy needs to come back. Okay, quick side definition, your ability to understand someone's emotions and put yourself in their position, right? I can never get empathy and sympathy correct. You all know what I mean. But like emotionally, I'm there. I'm there with you. Okay? And the shift in the leadership priority from a theme perspective is because it's going to increase decision-making, innovation, collaboration, and all the Asians. Right? By just bringing back this interpersonal skill called empathy. Human-centric. Stian, you mentioned the word human earlier. Like, I'm not just the autocratic boom, boom, boom. Like, how are you? Asking questions, really caring. Fascinating. Of all the competencies, empathy is coming back. The industrial psychologist in me, who used to be an assessment expert and still loves assessments, goes, geez, can you teach empathy? Let's circle back to that one. But it's coming. And then, the final trend of the evening, which is the perfect segue into Devandré, and that is the continued elevation of the CHRO, Chief Human Resource Officer, CPO, HR Exec, Head of HR, to be a trusted advisor in the C-suite. This whole conversation around taking back the seat or owning the seat around the table. And with that being said, I would love to introduce to you and welcome on the stage Devandré Lawrence. Before you clap hands, Devandré and I go a couple of years back. It's been a full circle, and I'm not going to share too much because you're going to share, but I want to honor your story. We recently recorded a podcast together, and Devandré shared his story. Don't know if you're going to share a bit of it tonight again, but the authentic way in which you have been vulnerable throughout your career, starting as an HR officer, it's been Pick and Pay, Nando's, KFC, and now HR head at Pernod Ricard. And Devandré, thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for sharing with us. Please join me on stage. Big hand of applause.
Thank you. There you go.
Wow, I can't believe that I'm standing in front of all of you. Like Francois shared, you know, it's been more than 10 years of a journey for me. I think a lot of us can share the sentiments coming into the HR space and into organizations and starting from the bottom. And often, if I look at the generations coming in, and the common question we ask is, what is your five-year career projection? And often it's, I want to be in a manager role, and I want to be head of department, and it's all beautiful, but it's the journey that counts, right? And I think I was very fortunate to have started on a graduate program with Pick and Pay. It was an 18-month graduate program. I joined as an HR intern, and I was fortunate to have a very strong mentor. And what she taught me at the time, it's not the success that you see today, but it's the everyday struggle and the consistency thereof that has brought me to where I am. And I couldn't comprehend it at the time, because I think, number one, my level of maturity wasn't really there, and the lack of experience and true exposure. And that's when I started to believe in showing up for yourself and what the true essence of authenticity is. And over time, you draw closer to that and you become a better version of yourself. And what's important in all of that is, don't be hard on yourself. Right? We're all going to make mistakes. We all fail, but we fail forward. You know. And it's about not making the same mistakes of yesterday, but making new mistakes that present today. And in doing so, you continue to grow closer and closer to yourself. So my journey has come a long way, from HR graduate to HR officer, as HR business partner for about 4 years. And then I was very fortunate to have led that HR BP team. And I think, you know, understanding all the fundamentals that come with it is important. It's not the image that you see from the puzzle that's created, but it's understanding the pieces that contribute to the image. And so I hope to leave some of that inspiration with you this evening. I hope to provoke, I hope to provocate, and I hope to inspire. So with that being said, before I kick off, I want to thank Francois and your team, the Wamly team. Like you've said, we've come a long way, but outside of that, I think, especially for people in our field, creating a space where we can lift up our heads from the desktop and all the challenges that we face with every day, and really just get an opportunity to be creative ourselves. You know, to have the opportunity to think beyond our realities and expand and stretch ourselves and get uncomfortable. You know, challenge our own thinking as well, because I think that's important for evolution. So thank you to yourself and the team. We recognize all your efforts for creating a space where we feel like we belong, and contributing to a greater society at large. So from all of us, thank you. So it starts with a thought, and I was very intentional about putting this up. I want us all to close our eyes, and we're going to get uncomfortable, okay, in the session this evening. So I want us to close our eyes, and for a minute, I'd like you to observe what your current thoughts are and be quite intentional about what's coming through. You're good. How many of the thoughts that you're currently having are familiar thoughts? If you can raise your hand. How many are familiar thoughts? There are a few hands up. How many are new thoughts that are coming through? Thoughts you've not had before. How many are repetitive thoughts? A few repetitive thoughts, right? Research shows, and I'll unpack this in my next slide, is that we have about 60,000 thoughts a day. That culminates to about 3,300 thoughts per hour. And when I was thinking about what to talk about this evening, I realized that everything around us stemmed from one thing. Who knows what that is? It's the thought, right? And so in our field, and as Francois presented, you know, what are the trends for 2024? What's coming? What is it that we need to prepare for? I try to think about what is the fundamental essence and principles we need before we build and acquire skill. And what came to mind was what gave birth to creation, and that is thinking, and it's innate in all of us. And how often do we foster our quality of thoughts and intentional about the quality of our thoughts? Because ultimately that's going to lead to the action that we're going to take. That's going to design the reality we have. So this evening I'm going to talk a lot about internal introspection. We were able to reflect and think about how thinking is going to elevate the skills that we require for the future. So I've caught myself doing this now. How many of us have started a sentence saying, "I think"? How often do we do that? We do that quite often, right? From saying, "I think," how many of our thoughts actually resulted into action? And I leave that for you to answer. I've shared with you 60,000 to 80,000 thoughts a day that stimulates through our mind. 2,500 to 3,300 thoughts per hour. I don't even want to know what that is like per second. I mean, it's a race going on in your mind, right? And the intentionality about us realizing what thoughts we're having. Now, why is this all important? Think about yourself in a strategy session and planning for the next 3 years. What are you leaning on? Your thoughts. What are you influenced by? Other people's thoughts. It's collaborative. And ultimately, when we get to a strategy and we get to the output, what has led that is the thinking that we follow through. So my provocation here is that before we focus on what are the skills that we require, is let's look inside and what is innate to all of us from humanity perspective, and that's our ability to think. And how do we foster and harvest quality thoughts that are going to lead to high impact actions? Okay. Before I move on to the next slide, I want us to close our eyes again and picture yourself using your dominant hand and drawing out your signature. That's quick, eh? Like a few seconds. The same time it takes for you to think about drawing out your signature is the same time it takes for you to physically write out your signature. Now, what that means is that if our quality of thoughts are good, and are trusted in ourselves, the quicker we can act on our thoughts, which drives efficiencies. What does that mean? That we can drive high performance through quality of thoughts. if we start entrusting our thinking from the onset and we are influenced by others that have as great quality of thoughts, the performance that comes thereafter is efficient and effective. So there's a cycle that we see coming through, a down think. I try to be creative and add some designs to my slides, so I think my words are thinking as well. So the more we start thinking about our thoughts, the more intentional we become around what we're thinking, right? And for me, that's how we're going to start bridging the gap. From an HR perspective, from looking at JDs to doing skills assessments to understanding skills gaps to trying to predict what skills are required and what skills are upcoming, we have these meetings constantly, right? They're part of our talent cycles, they're part of recruitment, they're part of acquisition, they're part of strategy. And the one thing that keeps coming to mind is, let's think about it, when we recruit for a position and we've got a shortlist, someone comes in, they do psychometric assessments. How many of us do psychometric assessments? Right? We assess against certain batches, what are the competencies of this individual aligned to the competencies of the role? How many of us follow through with that psychometrics throughout the employee's lifespan and life cycle? Or is it only momentarily for selection purposes? You follow through with that. I'd love to, like, if you can unpack that further. So how do you go about having that follow through? Like, what are the steps? Is it aligned to the person's development plan or... Yeah. I mean, that is vital. Vital. Like, I've had quite a few interviews in my career, and never have I seen my psychometrics follow through as I progress within my career. So how are we evolving the think of someone coming in, whether it be entry level or whether it be new to the organization, and how they evolve as an individual and as an employee? And how are we fostering that growth? Now imagine we do that for every employee and every person that walks through our doors. That's collaborative, because now we're having constructive, productive conversations. We are entrusting the quality of our thoughts, and that is driving culture of high performance. Right? So my provocation is here, opposed to looking for the output, let's look for the input. What is feeding in to the outcome that we want? Right? We sit around the table, scratch our heads, and say leadership is a key capability that we require. There's a lack of leadership. Where does leadership stem from? Now, if I look at the framework of leadership, there's leading self, there's leading others, and there's leading work and success. You don't have to be in a leadership position to be a leader. Okay, you can lead yourself. But it starts with mindset, with thinking. Okay, and we'll unpack that in the upcoming slides as well. Once we have a thought, right, our ideas come to life. And I think in conversation, right, imagine a world where before going into a meeting, you've got a 5-minute think tank. Just 5 minutes. And it's compulsory across the organization. Before going into any meeting, we start the meeting with 5 minutes think tank. And it's just debriefing on what is our thoughts. What is our state of mind and what is the quality of thoughts before we go into a meeting? How many of you think that would impact productivity? Again, very important around analyzing what's happening inside so that we produce what comes out of that and the output thereof. And this one is fascinating. So we talk about Gen Z. I see Marco is still not back. We talk about Gen Z and we talk about fostering a culture of belonging and inclusion, transformation, and all these sexy HR words. Right? What's important as well when it comes to quality of thought and thinking is perception versus perspective. And I think this is vital. Perception is how we experience our realities. It's what's in front of us. And all our perceptions may differ. Perspective is how do we elevate ourselves beyond the perception, understanding the environment and the circumstances we're operating in, where we actually have an opportunity to design and co-create our realities. And this is the provocation, is how do we get our employees to operate beyond what they perceive and start to understand and comprehend what perspective they have and what they've gained and how they influence others to think and have the same quality of thoughts. So again, for me, is what are we fueling in to get to the desired outcome that we want? And here you'll see quite a lot of synergy between what Francois and I spoke about. Again, at the foundation is what we think, and it's influenced by what we say, what we do, and how we are perceived. This has been a core lesson for me, is that as I started off my career, it was perception. Okay, my perception is this. And it drastically influenced a lot of decisions that I was taking and a lot of decisions that I was making, whether good or bad. The minute, and as I evolved, the minute I changed my perception to my perspective, I was able to bring a lot of factors together to not only make a decision, but make a decision that adds value and that contributes. And I think for us, especially the evolution of business partnership and being strategic advisors and owning a seat at the table, we've got the seat. But it's what are we doing with the seat that we occupy? More so than that, how are we challenging our stakeholders around the table to think differently and apply their thoughts differently, where they too are moved from perception to perspective? And I think that's the true value for HR, is sitting around the boardroom, is stretching our own selves, and we talk about HR moving from transactional to transformational, stretching our ability from being traditional in terms of our ways of work, and really understanding the nuances of the organization from start to finish. When I started at Pernod 3 months ago, one of my first tasks that I put for myself was sitting with every one of my stakeholders, including our CFO, which was quite daunting, and understanding the P&L. For me, it was around how do I support my key business stakeholders and partners when I don't understand the full functioning of our own business and the value that I contribute. And I had to elevate myself from what I perceive to what I've gained through perspective. And it's fundamental. So opposed to going into boardrooms and having discussions around what we would typically do, it's understanding what is our organization measured by, what is the vision that we want to achieve, and from a people, human capital, human resource perspective, how do I contribute to driving that vision and achieving those goals? And so stretching our own selves and making ourselves uncomfortable and challenging our own thinking is where it starts. Because if we don't do that, and we are the owners of people and we are the people's people, how are we going to change our current realities? And so important that we get ourselves into all aspects of the organization and start influencing our other executives and our other leaders to start doing the same and then cascading that down to their teams. But also, how do we harvest and nurture new people coming in, but also existing employees that are already there? And there's many tools that we can use to do this. I've seen this a lot of times in my career, especially in a one-on-one. You know, you get asked, what do I need to stop doing? What do I need to start doing? And what do I need to continue doing? Have any of you seen this before? A few of us have seen it. Okay. Is this normally asked to someone? How many of us have asked this from someone else? How many of us have asked this to ourselves? Well done. Okay, again, introspection, important. What do I need to stop doing? Okay. And again, it starts with what's going on inside here to get to 100% mindset. What do I need to stop doing? What do I need to start doing? And this is the challenge you put out to yourself. And what do I need to continue doing? What do I have belief in? And what do I need to trust in? And you can sense check this with your key stakeholders as well, which builds relationships. I love this slide. It's one of my favorite slides. What it is, what it could be. Okay? And stemming from quality of thought, looking at perception versus perspective, and understanding current reality versus potential reality. Self-awareness is the secret. Psychological mindedness is the tool. And what could be is the solution. How we drive experience for our employees. How often have we experienced the same? So if you think about the way you've been onboarded, if you think about the way talent conversations have been had with you, what you advocate for as the people's people in your organization and what you devote your employees to experience, do you experience the same? If we're honest with each other, and I'll leave you to answer that question yourselves. I think often we, in a rat race, we were trying to solve, and again, focused on the outcome, but we're not being self-aware as a function in terms of what we're trying to solve for and what could potentially be. Okay? Psychological mindedness is the intention and the being deliberate about what comes through and how we use that as a tool to foster what solutions we want. All of this has an impact on how we show up and how we perform. And my call to action and my ask is that we bring this to life. I think, including myself, if we talk about employee engagement, it's looking at an EAP. If we're talking about driving experience, we're looking at a wellness day. A lot of these things are periodic. But how do we bring this alive that becomes an everyday experience versus a date in a calendar? Where people own this themselves and they're aware of how they show up and not needing someone else to exemplify how they show up. Transactional and relational thinking. Transactional, what can I get? Relational, what can I give? And I think for me specifically, this endures a sustainable culture. Is changing the mindset. Often we talk about, we've spoken about thinking. We look at mindset and getting to 100% mindset. What does 100% mindset mean? It means that we're always switched on. Not switched on in terms of what we need to deliver, but switched on in terms of what's happening inside. And there's power in that. I promise you, there is massive power in that. So when doing things, it's not what can I get out of this. When looking at AI solutions, when looking at technology, when looking at policies and processes that we need to install, it's not about what can we get out of this. But it's more about what can I give. And this speaks to some of the trends that Francois spoke to as well. around what we do goes and extends beyond the job that we have. It's the impact that we're making that calls for a greater purpose. So once we do the shift, I think we'll revolutionize how we show up and how employees experience their everyday life. I do, however, think that it requires a balance. I think the one can't exist without the other. But again, how do we leverage from both?
Given that we live in South Africa, honestly, we do want to get the workspace in from a place of what can I get from you to what I can give you as the employer, as the manager, as part of human capital. We try and give either support, counseling, and so forth. But the question is not rather what can I get, what can I give, but how can I get from what can I get to what can I give you? That's the line, that bridge that takes us from the one space to the other. It's the more challenging part.
And I think what can I give speaks to what exists for you and how you contribute to something greater, being a piece of a puzzle. And again, elevating our perspective in understanding we can't operate in silos. Right? It's not a give and take. I'm contributing to something so much bigger than myself and my role. For me, that is the biggest capability that I've seen. I currently support blue-collar employees, and I support white-collar employees. And if I look at the vast difference between the two, is being able to stretch ourselves beyond what exists before us. We are focused on what is the job that we need to deliver on to get what I need versus what am I contributing to that elevates everything that I do and brings us all together. So when we talk about fostering a culture of collaboration, I think it's about changing the synergy of how we think from an organizational perspective. There was a question at the back. I mean, I love that as well, and we try and bring that in when we do career development discussions and we talk about talent cycles as well. But I've also seen lack of follow-through with that and intentionality around it as well, is that we put it as part of a PDP and we say, you own your development. And when we do calibrations, does that come alive? And who advocates for those employees?
This is very beautiful. But now, imagine you're a company now and we come from different backgrounds. And we need to put our people in this mindset.
Yeah.
And let's put a context in a factory company. So we have people on the floors. And then here we are HR, we know we want this, we have this mindset for our workers. Bearing in mind these people come from different backgrounds. And how do you teach this thing? Is it possible to teach someone who's very literate and dealing with that mindset? How do you do it?
In my experience, what I've done is be relatable in my conversation. In all honesty, it's to bring myself to the level of their thinking and have them comprehend my observation thereof, and then stretching them further and saying, and it's fostering the conversation with them, and it's being present, and that's what I love about business partnership and the exciting work that we do and able to do, is to mentor and coach ourselves. So for me, regardless of your walk of life or your quality of thinking, I think it's innate in all of us. It's how do we bring that to life? And I'd never go looking like this, firstly. So it's how we appear. It's how we present ourselves. It's the conversations we have. It's the combination of many things. But it's saying we are one. And this is what we're building towards. You might be contributing this. I might be contributing this. But together, we are achieving one common goal. And I constantly practice this from entry level all the way up. Because it's important we understand the importance of our own roles. and how unique that is and what we're contributing to and the opportunities that exist. We've just heard around, you know, your own ambitions in terms of your career and what you want to achieve. And some positions limit that because of thinking. And so typically, a cleaner wouldn't think of being the next CEO, but that's highly possible. So how are we creating common and shared experiences throughout levels? And that's why I put this as organizational. And I'll take it even further. I'll say it's beyond organizational. You know, I think we are all global citizens. And again, a provocation is we are fighting a war of talent. Really, we're fighting each other. Imagine a world we all come together where we are building skills that South Africa requires or Africa requires when we talk about talent mobility and access to talent, and we are all working to a shared goal. There is no war for talent because we are all benefiting in one way or another. But it's going to take each of us to advocate for that in our organizations. And I've seen it materialize in previous companies that I've been at, and it works phenomenally well. Yeah.
So previously, she was known as the cleaner.
Yeah.
And when she became a receptionist, she was now known as the receptionist. So if we don't question the why, you know, it's the what can I get? Why do you want to get that? What can I give? Why do you want to give that? You know, so again, it goes back to PDPs are very personal, but as HR, it is our responsibility to understand why it's so personal.
Beautiful. Okay, I've touched on this a bit, but to me, there's a clear connection between those four points on the screen. Thinking equates to mindset, mindset equates to action, and action equates to performance. It's understanding what is your starting point to get to the output. And by harvesting quality thoughts and how our employees are showing up and the think that they have is going to nurture them throughout their journey and is going to create the leaders that we foresee in the future. For me, skills is an enabler to our quality of thoughts. And so we talk about future leaders. What are the future leaders? Who are our future leaders? For me, it's future thinkers that's going to get to our future leaders. Right? So the more we harvest thinking across all levels, the more we harvest future leaders, understanding leadership framework that it could be leading self, leading others, leading work and success in all areas of leadership. And so what do we leave behind? And I was thinking about this, and IP came up. I got lost in the world of thinking about emotional intelligence, EQ, deliberating about IQ. And when I comprehended it, I understood that intellectual property is actually our legacy. And there was a comment early on down, I think, Temba, you were saying, you know, skills, retention of skills, and that it's not only dependent on an individual, but it's how do we keep that within an organization. For me, it's the legacy that speaks to that. Is what intellectual property are we harvesting for our employees? that not only sits within the organization, but extends beyond. That we create employability and understand that, yes, we want to drive retention, but if we are contributing to a greater society where we're alleviating unemployment, that to me is a value add as well. So if you look at the quadrants, concept, mental activity of a human, ability of memorizing and changing the environment, and live in the conscious, thinking, reading, studying, knowing the world around, and adoption of social experience. Composition is perception, memorizing, thinking, and speaking. Development, innate creative skills, mental abilities, intense activity and social factors, and level, determined according to the outcomes of the human activity and psychological tests. This is important because as we develop our intellectual property, which stems from our quality of thoughts that leads to mindset, action, and performance, something no one can take away from us. And if we install this in every human, in every employee, imagine the possibilities that exist beyond what we see today in the world that we can create, regardless of the skills that are required. And so I'm a lover for, I'm positive some of you have seen this before. This is a model that was communicated by AI HR, a sound follower of them. If you don't know them, please go search for them. Develop amazing tools that really stretches ourselves and creates training capabilities. But this is their prediction for HR trends 2024, and it's been impacted by feedback we have given, right? The first, I hope I'm not going to switch this off. Cool. Resolving the productivity paradox, tapping into the hidden workforce, the point of no return for DEIB, Francois. HR driving climate change adaptation from silos to solutions. HR leans in, HR meets PR, AI empowered workforce evolution, shifting work-life balance to work-life fit, the end of bullshit jobs, and from talent acquisition to talent access. If we are not stretching our own thinking and the quality of our thoughts, we're never going to get here. Right? Because we're not testing and challenging what is known to us and what is traditional for us. And far too often, the answer is, well, it is what it is. But we forget about the solution and what it could potentially be and why we are doing what we are doing. What stands out particularly for me is tap into hidden workforce. From small organizations, SMEs, to multinationals, how do we foster a sense of belonging? Right? When we are looking at talent, do we understand the talent that we are leveraging from and the talent that's come in? And does our systems and processes speak to us? And again, I think this is where technology can become very helpful. I am an advocate for technology, but again, I think it's about why do we need the technology that we have? And it takes a level of transparency for ourselves around what processes are not working. You know, often we try and justify our own policies and processes and say, well, and I catch myself doing it as well. It's the BCA, it's the LRA, it's legislative, and yes, that's our umbrella, but we can co-create and co-design what we foresee within the organization. And people want to be heard and seen. So how do we tap into that, which then speaks to talent access? Okay, DEIB. Beyond that is for C-suite and sitting around the boardroom is how do we create diversity with thoughts and thinking. That is as essential. It's for us to shift away from the traditional aspects of diversity and inclusion when we're looking at race, gender, sexual orientation, etc., etc. Those are all good and very important. But let's look at what are the intellectual capabilities that we need to drive diversity and inclusion within as well. And how are we challenging that around the table beyond what is seen? But what is conversational? Because that's going to drive strategy. And that's going to give us the roadmap to move forward. I'm not going to unpack the rest. I think Francois done a great job at speaking about some of the trends. But I leave this for you to ponder about. Just at the bottom, we've got three themes, and we've touched on this as well, realigning priorities. If I look at what's the current strategies that we're building within our own organization and what I've seen from my co-partners, colleagues, and other professionals, it's saying, what is the value add? Like, as the business has evolved, how are we evolving and how are we supporting the organization? You know, if we talk about increasing volumes and increasing revenue, do we understand the contribution that we make to that? A few years ago, for me, that conversation was, well, we do cost saving. So we've moved from agencies to in-house recruitment. We've centralized. We're saving the organization this amount of cost. And that was my reality. Okay. But for me right now, it's saying, as a business partner, how am I contributing to my organization's ambition? And that's a whole different conversation.
So these HR trends, yes, they are opportunities for, but do we consider the 21st century as a whole, or do we consider
post-COVID South Africa, and then we apply the trends due to post-COVID South Africa, or do we consider the HR trends within the 21st century?
I think it's both. I think we can't move away from what's happened post-COVID.
Yes.
A lot of our current policies are based on what we've experienced during 2020 to 2022.
2019.
Feels like a few years ago. And we look at the evolution thereof. Right? Again, I think you've brought up a beautiful point, is why take a disaster to happen for us to shift, when outside of that we could have challenged ourselves in our thinking and really create that space without having experienced what we did. And how do we do this consistently? Are we going to wait for another point in time that's going to make us shift how we apply ourselves and how we think? Or can we co-create that now? We are all together. And I think, again, you know, the opportunity that these spaces provide is where we can actually challenge and have these conversations and saying, when we're talking about Gen Z coming in, it's how do we make it more lucrative? And is the current contract types that we offer still conducive? And is it sustainable? Looking at what are some of the projections and trends that we see? If not, what does the alternative look like? Now, it's the follow through of our thoughts as well, which is important. It's not just about having an idea, it's saying, what is the scenario planning and what are the outcomes that are going to come from these ideas that we have? What is the best possible solution?
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
So I'll leave you with this. Everything starts with a thought. The results are seen all around us. Let's be intentional about the thinkers we are building to create future leaders that will leave a legacy we all desire. I thought long and hard about this. Seeds grow in silence. Trees fall with noise. Okay, how do we move from transactional to relational thinking? How do we observe the quality of thoughts of our employees that are going to result in action that's taken, shifting mindset and ultimately resulting in performance and solutions? Understanding we can't do this alone. And the more diverse we are from what exists in all of us, which is innate, the more all of us will feel like we belong, because it goes beyond this. And it goes inside. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And for the opportunity. Can we be back on stage?
There we go. Sure. Ladies and gentlemen, Devandré Lawrence. Thank you. Please have a seat. Before we do the Q&A, I promised prizes. So the first prize is for the chocolates. And the winner, before I announce the name, the winner's comment was, changing HR trends, modernizing recruitment and hiring, let's contribute to sustainability, embrace technology within the workplace. Hashtag human capital, hashtag recruitment, hashtag AI, hashtag tech, hashtag Wamly. Well done, Karabo M. Also vocal tonight on the questions and comments. Thank you for your contributions. I said that the red wine, I am going to pose a question while listening to Devandré, and the first person whose hand goes up and has got the right answer is going to win by a slew of pinatosh. Okay, so Devandré had a slide up where he said, the one thing leads to the next, leads to the next, leads to the next. Do not look at your photos right now. Thinking leads to mindset. Mindset leads to action. Action leads to what? I'm going to phone Wimbayers. Jeez, I don't know whose hand went up first. Okay, wait, I've got a second question. Now, honestly, like, literally, I don't know. Okay, you help me see whose hand goes up first. Okay. Leadership starts with what? Leadership starts with what? Okay, I'm going to give the second hand. No, it does not start with thinking. Beauty. Well, yeah. No, not your thoughts. Yes. Mm-mm. Nope. You can't win again. It's not your thoughts. Okay, obviously this is too difficult. I'm going to give two more. It's good, but... Nope. At the back? No, it's not thoughts. It was a... Nope. Idea, no. Okay, I'm gonna give you a clue. So the thoughts is in what the right answer is, and it's not the head. Mindset. Who said mindset? Yes! Mindset. Well done. Congratulations. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to sit down on the couches. We'll have a Q&A. We've got two mics. There's a mic with Andre. There's a mic with Gideon. Raise your hand. They'll give you the mic. The mic is important because we want everybody to hear. Okay? When we're done with the Q&A, please don't run away because I still have one more prize. Okay? So, we'll hoy the last slide up, complete that, and then we are going to do networking, drinks, more food, photos, questions, whatever you want to do. No one has got an 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. Okay.
Church.
Very valid. Okay. First question.
Conversational. Or comment. Or an idea.
Or a thought.
I love that. Denial.
I think throughout the evening, the most prominent trend was DEIB. Mm. And I think one of the questions I'd like to pose to you guys and also to us as HR is, how do we redefine what DEIB is when it comes to job descriptions, performance appraisals, and future thinking, you know, the succession planning and things like those. How do we redefine that, and what does it look like?
I mean, that's a really tough one, and I had a conversation earlier on about something quite similar in terms of different people walking through our doors and unboxing what that means. Right? And I think we've intentionally boxed a lot of things because it makes it easier for us to categorize. We have to be honest with ourselves and acknowledge that there is points of difference before we can build JDs and before we can understand roles, responsibilities, competencies, attributes, and all of the other good stuff. We need to understand the people that are occupying those roles. And I think it evolves every day. If we look at, you know, gender identities and how that has transformed and how that is coming to life and how we show up our diversity of thinking. And for me, it's how do we go from traditional balding and job descriptions, which also impacts grading and bans, and I mean, it has a whole ripple effect, because you talk about job description, you talk about job grading, you talk about compensation, benefits, rewards, and we're gonna have to be honest with ourselves. And then understand, you know, do we look at competencies differently? Because we have uniqueness in an organization, and the level of diversity we thought exists is different to what is. And as I provocated early on, it's not what is, it's what could be, you know? And so we need to look at other attributes. Are we just putting the attributes in for the sake of putting it in and filling a space? Or are we really intentional about why that is there and what that means for the most suitable individual for that role? So it takes a lot of unpacking, a lot of acknowledgement before we build and create.
There's a hand. Good.
Thanks. Firstly, thanks very much for this evening and for everything that you shared. It was extremely insightful. So my question is about reskilling. There is a tremendous interest in, for me, in how AI is changing the landscape, the tools that we're using. And so I've got a question for both of you. One might be personal, so I do take no for an answer. Francois, the one is for you. How did you reskill, or maybe you did not need to reskill, when you moved from industrial psychology to starting Wamly? And then to both of you, what do you see works? What actually works for people who need to seriously start to think about reskilling now with AI and jobs changing significantly? It has changed already. It's not changing. It has changed already. I see this daily working in technology. So I would really appreciate your answers on that. Thank you.
Awesome. I'm happy to answer the question. Firstly, a lot had to change. As an industrial psychologist, you know, we get trained to be experts and to think in a very specific way, governed by very specific frameworks and models, and, you know, and then to step into the world of entrepreneurship and tech and HR tech, it was a total shock. I remember I was the founder, but I wasn't the first CEO. So Marnus Broedrijk was the first CEO, and things changed, and I then had to take over CEO without even being asked. And so that in itself, you know, starting Wamly with Marnus and then the next moment you're the CEO, took enormous change. And it took me 16, 17 months to fully immerse myself in this role. And what did I have to do? I think firstly, I had to accept what I don't have yet. You know, often being vulnerable is not easy, especially when you're on a stage and when you're a persona to a specific group of people. And, you know, it starts with yourself and your employees. and to say, listen, I'm not that assertive. I'm not that shrewd. I'm not that harsh. I struggle with making hard, quick decisions. I am accommodating. So I had to let go of that side without changing who I am and understand how can I be what is required from the role given from the perspective who I am as a human and then as an industrial psychologist. And so to be vulnerable and authentic around going, okay, what do I not have? And then actively identify what is required. And then also accept that there are certain things like a P&L that I'm never going to understand. I'm perfectly okay with that. And then to find someone who can, instruct them and trust them. So I hope that answers your first question. A lot of self-awareness. I think secondly, the people side, right? What do I see it really working with people? Was that your second question? Sure. How do we get people to reskill? I said it earlier, and it is in my story, and that is it's the willingness, firstly, to want to. I think we can't make anybody anything. You know, the technology and the environment and the job at hand and the context of the work environment will shift and change. And then the opportunity might be there for Temba to move with it, and then the organization is going to either help or not. But at some point, and I think we said it earlier around the call center environment example as well, is, you know, the employee must also want to. But that is also not enough, because I can be really want to be a doctor but not have the cognitive ability to be one. You know, and so somewhere in career guidance or career counseling, we also run into these conversations to tell Johnny, maybe, you know, engineering is not it. So, and you know, I think we need to be very open and transparent and authentic around, you know, capability, motivation, inherent characteristics, willingness, initiative. I mean, so many of these layered elements come together to unpack that question, can people? With that being said, could the Springboks twice in a row? And it happened. So I mean, your story is as inspiring, you know. Mm. So I don't think I'm answering you, but I think it's okay.
Yeah. Maybe just to build on that, like the way I practice it personally is integrating it into everything that I do, and also what is the application of skills that I have, because if you don't keep practicing the skill, you tend to lose the framework and kind of the relevance of the skill as well, and skills evolve. So again, I think it speaks to so many things around the position and saying, you know, are we optimizing the role and the individual in that role, and are they practicing and harvesting the skills every day? And then using that as an opportunity to upskill and reskill. We see those being two fundamental focus areas for us at this moment. Right, it's how do we retain institutional knowledge, and then how do we upskill and reskill so that we don't lose that IP from an organizational perspective. It's about doing it every day and finding opportunity to do it. I think as things shift, as Wallet saying, opposed to me just giving you a project, is do you have the right skills to deliver on the project? And then looking at the tools to upskill, which is the beautiful tools that you referenced in terms of Coursera and other modules that are available out there. And how diverse is that? Does it speak to the individual's learning capability? Is it agile? Is it future fit? There's so many attributes that contribute to it that it's difficult to pin it down onto one thing.
Can I just add one last thing to that? I think it also depends on the context of the organization. So let me take Wamly as an example. If I need a senior back-end developer, as much as I would love to bring in a graduate and create an environment for flourish and grow and skill and retrain and upskill, I might not have the time. So I think we also need to understand, you know, as an organization and as trends, we speak a lot about it's our responsibility, upskill, reskill. To what extent do we have the time? Can we afford to do it? I think big, larger corporates potentially have a better opportunity to do that, but some environments just don't. And so I need the right skill at the right time now.
Right place.
Right place, thank you. There was a hand.
So, can you hear me? Okay. So I'm also in the HR field, but like in the hospitality environment. I work at the Saxon Hotel. So we know that the hospitality industry is a low skilled environment. However, what we do, we basically have a term called cross-training to reskill the employees. For example, you have a chef, she wants to cross-train in front office as a guest relations officer or in the F&B department to basically have an idea of the kind of guests that they are cooking and catering for. So we have something called cross-training, and I think it works pretty well for their personal development. It's just a comment.
Yeah. Hello, Francois. Hello. Sorry, what's your name?
Devandré.
Sorry. I have more of a comment, and I'd like to hear your thoughts on it if you have any. It's around the theme of artificial intelligence, but it touches on a bunch of other themes as well. Last year, at the start of the year, I realized there were a bunch of what I call secret cyborgs in our organization, people who were using AI and presenting the AI work as their own. So there might be some ethical issues with that on the one side, but on the other side, some managers found out about this and then just thought, well, the work gets done anyway, so there's nothing to address actually. So, but then we started presenting an AI workshop and training to reskill people on this. And now I like what Devandré said on integrating new skills in your work, because we saw three things. The main differences between people who really started using AI and incorporated it in their work and the people who just watched the videos on the AI training and then just went on doing everything the same way. The first thing was that they really tried to incorporate it in how they did their daily work every single day, thought about how might I use AI to help me write this email or build this template or whatever. That's the first thing. The second thing was that they spent at least, I'd say, 10 hours just playing around with this new technology. I think it takes at least 10 hours to get used to the what they call the jagged frontier of AI. So there might be some fields where AI can function at a master's level, but other fields not even at a undergraduate level, right? So then you need to personally figure out what that difference is. And the last thing that was interesting to me is they told me that they tried to view their chatbot or whatever they were using as a person rather than a system or a technology, because that's the way that the AI usually responds, as a person. And I want to bring in the themes of the empathy and the more humane way of HR into this as well. So two examples I can give of using AI in my HR work was, first of all, after writing an email, just posting it into ChatGPT and asking it to make it more, to use more empathy in how I write the email and send it, so that I can train my empathy. Your question on whether you can train that as well. And highlight where we might we make things more human, right? And it created better emails than I would write on my own. And it's not a human thing, but if we see it as human and can teach us human skills and knowledge, it might help with that part. And then the other thing was the translating the general purpose templates and theories and HR knowledge into context-specific use cases. So you might have a general competency framework of what we need in a specific role, but then we can use the AI to generate context-specific questions from that framework for an interview, for example. So we can use whatever research we can find for general purpose, and then just ask the AI to make it context-specific because we need someone who will fit in this culture and does this specific skills are needed. So that translation part. So those are just my thoughts and ideas. I'd like to hear what you think about that as well.
I think there's a lot in that. But for me, it's how is AI going to enable what I need to do? And again, you have to strip down the noise and understand what is the value that you contribute, what piece are you playing in all of this, and how AI can give you the insights and the information you require to make better decisions and more impactful decisions that are related to exactly what we've spoken about today. You know, what are the trends that are coming? What do we predict coming through as well? AI should be an enabler, and we as individuals feed into that. And as an output, we create a better environment for everyone to thrive in. And that's it for me. Is if I can get something that's going to help me to do a better job and to make a higher impact, why not?
Yeah, I think just my contribution, one sentence. Organizations and individuals are going to decide whether they will or will not engage with it.
Yeah.
If the organization does not, as a holistic, decide to engage with it, the fact that I then get caught out might be frowned upon. But if we are encouraging engagement, it'll be a tap on the back. Well, well done. And then the same with the humans. And then if you're engaging with it more, who knows? More now, you might then become more empathetic and not need AI in a year to write your empathetic email.
Thanks. I think my contribution regarding the question you asked earlier on and Francois, what you've just spoken about, is really around the role we play as people practitioners, right? We've spoken about a lot of stuff today, starting from skills-based organizations, right? And it reminds me of the research that was done in terms of tribes, where you move away from the traditional job description and you start literally, you know, allocating your people, your human capital, or your resources based on their skills as projects. So they move away from the traditional job, they go into a project, and then they come back. So there's no, this is my position. And why I'm saying this is because I believe the foundation is really in talent management. We heard how Ocean Basket deliberately has, you know, those, I call it bounce discussions, right? Because it's the 7 Bs, it's talent management, it's build, buy, borrow, boost, you know what I'm saying? And in there, there's a bounce conversation, and those are enabled through talent dialogues. What I've seen is we have a lot of performance dialogues versus talent dialogues. And we have talent dialogues with either your hypos or your key contributors, and we leave the rest of the guys, versus if maybe we changed our mindset and we have more talent dialogues with everybody else versus performance dialogues, it allows us the opportunity to talk about where the opportunities to reskill. Where's that? What's the talent mobility for you? You know, what's the next job, which is a talent exchange program for you? Not necessarily that you're going to be promoted, but it could be a secondment. So I'm thinking from a people perspective, once we understand the new employment deal, which you've spoken about, right, which talks about flexibility, connectedness, and purpose, meaning, which is your EVP, and then you enable that where you're saying the individual and the organization can engage, you facilitate that through talent dialogues, regular talent dialogues, I think we might start to move and enable our line managers and leaders in terms of, you know, shaping how we help them enable, achieve the business objectives. Yes, the P&L is important for the, you know, the business acumen, but we can help, you know, the organization achieve their mission and their vision. Thanks.
That deserves a clap, yeah.
I just have a question about, you mentioned the one statistics that the employees are leaving after 18 months. So historically, HR has focused on retention as a very important KPI. Do you see that changing in the future or not really?
I'm going to answer that by stealing, Temba, your insight. I think that was a big aha moment for me as well tonight, is retention of skills or retention of people? And I think the nuance might be around, depending on the role and the level. If you ask me, do I see it changing? I don't think it's going to slow down. Might the 18 months become 16, 14? Who knows? We need to go to the why. Why are the people moving? Why did my grandfather stay in Koppies for 30 years with his watch, to get his golden watch? Versus why are the Gen Zs and the younger generations shifting for the 18 months? We could derive certain answers, meaning, purpose, job satisfaction. Am I being heard, listened to? Am I contributing in line with what I would like to do? Is the job boring? Did I have a misperception around what I was going to do and what I'm doing now? This often happens, especially with the younger generation, where, you know, I want to come in and change the world, and the first 6 months is admin, you know, and so, okay, I'm moving, especially if I have a qualification and a scarce skill. I don't want to pick on the developers, I have my own, but I mean, that is, you know, everybody wants to be a senior backend, full stack, immediately. So I'm not too sure to predict it, but I don't think it's going to slow down.
Maybe to build as well, I think with retention for me is again the why. Why are we retaining and how is this contributing to building the organization we want? Is it retaining an individual? And why are we retaining that individual? Is it institutional knowledge that they hold, or is it capability that they have? But then we need to have deeper conversations. How are we transferring skills? How are we developing with succession? Because there needs to be a solve for that. And also, when we retain, are we retaining to build or are we retaining to keep?
It's an easy one. How likely is it that HR will get over its own BS?
Over its own?
BS.
Is it a question?
It's a question.
Real question.
How likely is it that HR is going to get over its own bullshit? What bullshit? All of it? The models, the theories, the fancy chats, the... Look, I mean, I've stood on this exact stage and I've said that I often enter into conversations where HR is complaining about being stuck or complaining about not having a voice around the table or complaining about not being allocated a budget or complaining whatever. And then I often will answer, a huge part of that is your own fault. Do you know and truly understand the frustrations of your line manager? Are you involved in financial decisions or the strategy of the business unit or why the turnover is so high? Or are you busy with admin, screening CVs, and compiling IR cases? So I think we can get out of or over our own bullshit by getting out of our own way. And if HR is able to transition away from the conditioning around things need to be difficult and manual so that I can complain and then go home to and wait for Friday, I think then maybe we can get over our own bullshit and start making an impact. Because the opportunity, the floor, the table has never been better set than it is now. There's such a spotlight on human capital, now more than ever. And I'm not even in an HR department. I'm saying this as someone who's observing HR and has been observing HR for 13 years. Let's now just step into it.
Sorry if that was harsh.
I attest to what you're saying, Francois, completely. I've been in a situation where I've redefined the function completely. Obviously, it comes with being credible and being able to speak the language and show up the way that you do so that you're a trusted advisor. But it's also knowing the direction that you want to take. I also believe that we need to start unboxing. There's too many boxes, and especially in our space where we try to make things fit in the boxes that we have. And actually saying, if it was a blank canvas, what would it look like? And then building on what that could potentially be. The same as we do for our line managers. If we sit and a line manager comes and says, D, I've got this position, I need to do a job description and profile this role. We ask the questions, right? Who's this position? Who's this person reporting into? What are the competencies required? Do we constantly ask ourselves that? And so we give service to the organization, but do we give service to ourselves? And it's HR for HR. We need to take each other on the journey. And we, as we move forward, we need to move forward collectively.
Baby here, I'm an employer branding specialist. Finally got the mic. So what I've noticed so far in the past few years within my role is that I believe a lot of HR people, and I'm not being fascist or any other way or bad, but I think a lot of HR specialists or HR people are ignoring the fact that you actually have human within your human relations title. And you should be taking that part as the first part before anything else to actually take away all the clutter and start saying what's happening from the human space. And I understand that this could also be a problem or also an Achilles heel for us in Africa most of the time, because we have this thing that we link to legacy, like Devandré said, where our culture more in Africa is more to be more receptive to what our older generation used to do. So this becomes an Achilles heel to us to not think that we are actually beyond where we are. I don't believe that we are actually 10 steps back from what the world is. I do believe we're still learning because we're quite young within the whole space of human capital, as the research shows. That's why a lot of companies are coming into our space and a lot of countries are coming to poach our clients and our talent. And you get developers now leaving jobs in 10 months or less. So I think that we need to get out of our own way, like Francois just mentioned, and actually look at the whole part of unpacking where the human part is and what Devandré was actually touching on what can I give and what can I get, which is what the new Gen Z is bringing into the fore, to say, what can I give you, but what can you help me in my community, which is what COVID showed a lot of people, to say, my next door neighbor doesn't have bread and they're struggling with this, how can I help them with that? So a lot of that opened up a lot of spaces, and I think that if we keep delaying, more so as an African or South African space, that's where we're actually creating the big steps between us and everyone else in the world, whereas we're actually quite on the same level, we just don't see beyond our veil, so to say. So that's my comment.
I just want to make mention, I also am conscious and respectful of time. We can sit here the entire evening. We can. It's 9 o'clock now. This is why this exists. Okay, so I just want to say this is beautiful. This is phenomenal. But just know that I am conscious and we have one prize left, but I don't want to rush this, but also not drag it. So after this, there is a networking session where we can have small little conversations as well. So let's play it. If we kind of see antsiness too much and I have to run and left or my Uber is here, whatever. Let's not create a disconnect before we end the evening. So let's maybe do 4 or 5 more questions. Okay. Let's do 3 more questions and then we do the last thing and then we go and have a drink, run to the loo, and then have these conversations individually, meet each other. Cool.
Okay. I think I've asked so many questions. I'm sorry, guys. What I use as my holy grail in human capital is Dave Ulrich's model. So it says human capital serves as an administrative expert, a change partner, a strategic expert, and a people champion. But one thing I've realized in human capital, we can't always be that. We're so stuck on being the administrative expert, being the people champion. We forget about being the strategic partner, being the change manager. And one thing I found very beneficial in our companies, having an operations manager. And often we think that it's human capital and the line manager together, but I think having the role of having an operations manager helps balance the relationship between human capital, operations to team leader or line manager and so forth. So I think we should always stress on or addressing the importance of having an operational aspect or operational department in the company to support not only human capital, but also management, team leaders, and so forth. Because I have seen that it's been beneficial in playing that role of support on both sides and not only having human capital try to be a strategic partner, but they can't always be. So I think having operations in a business is a vital thing to have, and it is important to have, and I would recommend most business to look into having operational management structured put in into the business.
Git, you've been a hand here for quite some time.
So I think the interesting thing to me is we're sort of accepting as a society that things are fluid. But here we are trying to channel profession into a way of we all have to do whatever, right? So I think the main thing that I've even seen over the years in org design or whatever is, to your point, you have like an op side and you have an enablement side, but it takes different people to do it. Not everybody should be an enablement. Like, the enablement side is whatever, it's sort of the behind-the-scenes sort of thing that enables the ops department, and whether it's an HR, whether it's in the company, you have these two forces working together. And I think what I've seen over the years, as somebody like that oversees interns every year, is like we all have this vision of what the ideal state is of our profession, but we're actually so harsh to ourselves. Like, we should just say, what is our natural tendencies? Because there's a space for that. Yes, it's great that some people are pioneers in technology and are pioneers in those things, and there's a space for that, but there's a big space for people that are good with operations. And in fact, we will not be able to focus on any other things if those things don't get tended to. So I think it's like, even to the point of skills development, I always find it an interesting conversation because I also do that for our organization. And I think it's to Francois' point earlier, like, I am a big believer that the employee needs to be in the driver's seat. Like, I can have the most beautiful plans and strategies and whatever, but if I don't have willing people that are capable. So that's where our other conversation comes in with the 90 box. And I know some people use it as a tick box thing, but if you use that thing as it's meant to be, you'll have the people that you need to develop, the people that fall in the enablement side and the people that fall on the upside. And you'll meet the people where they're at, because it also fluctuates sometimes. Sometimes somebody has the ambition to go to that next level, and sometimes somebody has three little kids at home and they have ambition for nothing except the thing that they're good at, and you need to meet the person where they're at. So I think, like, we have to apply that fluidity to professionalism. Like, we don't all fall in the same box. And we do need pioneers that drive this thing forward, but we also need people that can maintain the system and be okay with it and be really good with it. And I don't ever want, not that I'm saying that's what's happening, I'm just saying, like what I've seen with supervising interns, like, people feel some sort of way because they don't fit a certain mold. And I'm like, but the mold that you are is exactly the perspective that we're missing. Right? Because we all have our unique things. And I think, like, maybe it's the course I'm doing on LinkedIn about design thinking or systems thinking that's making me think about this, is where they describe that our professional expertise isn't the box that we're in, but it provides us with this unique perspective to solving the problem. And if you're great at operations, you bring that unique perspective to solve a problem. If you're great at pioneering, you bring a unique perspective to transcend possibly. So I just wanted to sort of make that point for somebody that's great in operations out there and you're comfortable in that, like, you do that, right? There will be someone that drives the other agendas going forward, but like, we need everybody as part of the bigger puzzle. So I just wanted to.
Okay, let's do one more question. Love the passion. One more question. If there is not one more question, that's perfectly fine. Can you click once more? Okay, so we're going to end off the session. I would encourage you to please scan that QR code. As I said earlier, this will not take long for you to complete. Simba, are you ready in the back end? Yeah, okay, great.
Is that man? Perfect.
I've been living, but I know I can't resist it. Oh, I love it and I hate it at the same time. You and I drink the poison from the same vine. Oh, I love it and I hate it at the same time. Hiding all of our sins from the daylight, running from the daylight. From the daylight, running from the daylight. Oh, I love it and I hate it at the same time. Telling myself it's the last time. Can you
see? Seems like. Okay, I'm gonna give everybody a fair chance because this is a randomized winner. So, if you're not done yet, everybody done? I think there's. Couple more to my left. It looks like you're done.
Yes.
And are we done here on this side? Okay, Simba, spin it. No, not yet. Okay, spin it. No, you've won already so much. Spin it, Simba. While Simba's doing that, I want to end off by thanking all of you for staying after nine, for really engaging, for asking great questions, for contributing. Thank you, Devandré, for your wonderful keynote. What I loved about and what I took away from Devandre's keynote is the power of the mind. And often I think we miss that. We're so busy and we're so chasing our own tail that we don't stop and think. And I think I said, I think, a thousand times tonight. And so do I really think or do I just do? So thank you. That was so inspirational. I really appreciate it. to all of you here, if you have to go, of course, you're so welcome to do so. But if you can stay, let's stay. Let's have a drink. Let's eat something. Let's take a photo. Let's have a chat. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being wonderful people, people part of the Wamly community, clients, new faces, students, interns, Wamly employees. Have an absolutely beautiful, blessed Easter. Go and enjoy the last long weekend for a long time. Thank goodness this is now done. But no, go and rest. And thank you for following us. Thank you for the journey. Thank you for being here. And thank you for sharing your thoughts, your wisdom, and your energy tonight. Thank you so much. Oh, the winner. Did you WhatsApp me? Okay. Like that beautiful ending, and I'm not done yet. Okay, and the winner is... Tebogo Morena. Are you here? Oh, there we go. Okay, now we're done.